just when you thought things are slowing down and we're bogged down, we're stagnated, nothing's happening, you look around and suddenly everything's happening and it's like speeded up, warp speed. So there's a calm before the storm, and we've been going through that calm the last couple weeks. I was given the heads up to take about 10 days off and to calm down and be centered, and that's when the maha mantra was given to me, and I started applying that and test piloting that to see how it works. It's been absolutely fascinating, because one is able to see all the tricks that the mind plays to try to get you away from it. So the ego tries to get you away from that, because that's the end of the ego. Is now is concurrent with time. That's the end of the ego. It's the end of time. And interestingly enough, then the new Pope is saying very interesting Freudian slips about the end of the world, and 112th Pope of Malachi's prophecy is the last one, Peter the Roman. And of course, he is Peter the Roman, being an Italian, taking the name Francis de Pietro, St. Francis de Pietro, St. Francis of Peter. So there you go, Peter the Roman. So everything is speeding up now, because the time is now, and what we need now is stable mind, stable mind, stable mind. That's what we need. So that's why the maha mantra was given out to me to share with the world. First, to test pilot it, to stabilize my mind, and it's been an amazing experience. Nothing weird or drastic or anything like that. It's simply you see how the mind tries to shift you away, the tricks it plays, and then you just say, no, now it's concurrent with time. Now it's concurrent with time. Don't get engaged in any conversation, inner conversation. Just simply, now is concurrent with time. And all the weird stuff, not weird stuff, but whatever happens in your life, you will find that the mind is saying, hey, pay attention to that. And you say, no, now is concurrent with time. Let me pay attention to this. Because that literally is the answer. That the answer was given concurrent at the same instant as the problem arose, which is our presumption that there's a continuity issue. There really isn't any, because the answer has always been there. But we assume there's a continuity problem, which is really why we maintain our allegiance to this nightmare we call existence, is because we assume there's a continuity problem. And the answer is not to solve the continuity problem, but to realize that there's never been a continuity problem, because the solution was given concurrent, not before and not after, but concurrent at the same instant. Continuity problem has never been there. So we've just been assuming, mistaken assumption is what keeps us bound to this nightmare. That's all. That's the only thing that keeps us bound, is a mistaken assumption. So now is concurrent with time, is the great maha mantra, great statement of truth, that the continuity issue never arose. We just presume that it has arisen. We presume that there's a continuity problem between dreaming and not dreaming, because we don't have any way to get a dream that mimics reality. The dream that mimics reality is a dream of non-judgment, which is the now. The now is non-judgment, because non-judgment doesn't need time, does it? Perfect non-judgment doesn't need any time at all. See, the Prime Creator simply did not judge what-ifs at all. Dreams, hypotheticals, just saying all hypotheticals are equally inconsequential to reality. So there's no reason to judge this and that and that. So non-judgment upon all of them. Non-judgment. Don't need any time for non-judgment. Non-judgment, one judgment for all dreams forever. How much time does that require? An instant is all it requires. So that instant is right now. It's concurrent. It was concurrent with the beginning of dreaming. It's always been there. This blessing of non-judgment has always been there. It doesn't take any time at all. Non-judgment doesn't take any time. It's judgment that takes time. As we're sorting everything out, trying to look for a way to complete, to make illusions real, to make death real, to solve the continuity problem. We're searching, wandering, searching, like ants wandering for food, looking for some little morsel somewhere. And all this while, that takes time. That takes a lot of time, doesn't it? But non-judgment, perfect non-judgment doesn't, it takes an instant, concurrent instant, that's it. So we need to just remind ourselves that the answer has always been with us. Now is concurrent, meaning at the same instant, concurrent with time, the searching, the looking for something, the saying that time is saying we don't have it now, so we need to keep looking for it. And each moment we say, well, we don't have it yet, we don't have it yet, that's time, we don't have it yet, we don't have it yet, we still have a problem, we still have a problem, we still have a problem, we're looking for the answer, we're looking here and there, time and space. How much space does non-judgment need? How much space, how much time? Doesn't need time, it doesn't need space. Absolutely doesn't need time or space. It's searching that needs time or space, searching for an answer, searching for a way to make illusions real, make death real, make to change reality, then search or searching for the answer, the continuity issue, takes time and space. But non-judgment is right here, right now. There was a book by Ram Dass saying, be here now, right here, right now. Be here when now. See, that's the place of non-judgment, perfect non-judgment. That's the resolution to our fears about the continuity problem that resolves our fears. So at this time, when world events are going to, what's happening in the world is fragmenting. And I'm telling you, the attempts to pull my mind in this direction or that direction, become aware of it, and using the maha-mantra, you suddenly become aware of all these attempts to get you going in this way or that way, or investigate this, do this, do this, all of it, waste of time, meaningless, futile. And yet the mind, thought forms of the world try to grab a hold of us. And we just, instead of responding, we just don't respond at all. We just say, now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. That immediately centers us in the moment, immediately melts away these efforts. We get spraying ourselves with Teflon. Teflon, we're all Teflon. And these thoughts can't get a grip on us anymore. The Maha Mantra is like a Teflon coating. It's what the gurus have always tried to get us to do, except we don't do it usually. They really come here saying, look, can I interest you in doing the Maha Mantra? Because they know that works. And they know the other stuff doesn't work. So they want to interest us in that, and yet we're so resistant. We want to like discuss and have dialectic talks with them about stuff, and they just don't want to. Which is why a lot of them are just like quiet most of the time. Because they don't want to respond to, they don't want to encourage our dialogue like that. It's not necessary. It doesn't work. Because it's all based on the presumption that we don't have the solution, that somehow the answer to the continuity problem was not concurrent, not at the same instant. That it had to be either before or after, and then therefore we have a problem. We have a problem with God, and we have to figure out what to do about that problem. And so we need to dialogue and talk and discuss and think about it and all this kind of stuff. Whereas the gurus, they know there's no problem. And so they just say, just do the Maha Mantra and you will soon see that there is no problem and that these thoughts cannot get a hold of you anymore. And so they have a few students who actually do it. And then the rest of them want to worship the guru. They say, I'll tell you what, guru, let's make a deal. And the guru is not Monty Hall. They're not here to make a deal. They're here to tell you what works. But we say, let's make a deal. We'll worship you in exchange. We don't have to do the Maha Mantra. How about that? And the guru say, no deal. And we say, how could you turn such a great deal down? Are you kidding? We'll worship you forever, but we'll make you higher than God. We'll do whatever you want. And is that okay? And the guru says, no. Forget it. Just start trying to say some affirmations. Try to shift into that affirmative mode. And so they work with those who want help to say, Shift into that affirmative mode, even if it's simple. Now, what they do is they, for those who have a lot of trouble, they start out with some song, call and response, some kind of music or something that everybody can feel, oh, I like this. And then along with the song, be shift into affirmative mode by being affirmative, by stating something very simple and basic and affirmative, blanket statement. They start with that, and then they gradually increase to where one can dispense with the music, etc. Those are the real teachers. The ones who know how to gradually attract you and encourage you towards the maha mantra, towards the statement of truth. Now is concurrent with time. Total blanket statement. Now is concurrent with time. Complete blanket statement. We have to train our minds, train ourselves to accept blanket statements that are true, completely true. Right now, right here, right now, completely true, not needing time or space at all. We have to train ourselves to get used to that, to familiar with it, and so I can say, I understand that, I accept that, because we're so fragmented into the search, which goes into details. So we're lost in a forest, and we're trying to get out, but we're examining every little tree and every bit of bark on the tree. We're like going along a path to get out of this dark forest, and we're looking around and say, oh, look at that tree. Oh, that's an interesting tree. And then we start studying the bark. Look at the bark pattern on this tree. And the guru says, hey, how about this tree up there? Let's check that one out too, right? And try to get the attention off of this tree. And let's talk about trees. How's this tree like other trees? And let's make a song about all the trees in the forest. And trying to get the mind to shift into generalization mode instead of specific detailed mode. Because details are always what derail you. Truth is true. It's always been true. There's no detail about it. There's nothing to examine about it. No conclusion to be reached but through examination of it. And it's true forever and for always. In all cases, there are no cases for it because it's always true. There's no detail in reality. There's nothing like that. It's all one. So, but we have, in the search, we have trained ourselves to be detail-oriented, specific-oriented, fragmented, let's examine this little part under the microscope instead of let us accept that truth, that God is God, truth is true, and now is concurrent with time. Let us accept that. We have a severe problem with that, severe difficulty doing that. And so what the teachers do is they gradually attract us back to being able to do that, and then eventually one is able to take up the maha mantra, which is what they really want us to do. Their efforts are designed towards getting as many people as possible to be using a maha mantra, a great mantra that is endowed with tremendous Teflon capacities, that they call Jesus the Christ, the anointed one with oil, that's another sign of like the Teflon coated with oils, like a Teflon type of coating, and nothing sticks to it, as it were. It doesn't get contaminated. It's like a protection where the thoughts of the world cannot get a hold and grab it. So the maha mantra, the great affirmation, the great prayer does that. It does that. The difficulty is in actually doing it. I've finally been able to actually do it, and I get it. I get it now. Whereas before I didn't get it, of course. So that's to be expected. But I worked up to it gradually, finally reached a point where it was combustible. And so that's a great step forward, is someone who's able to actually use the maha mantra, as opposed to a mantra, or as opposed to discussion, as opposed to thinking, etc., etc. Maha mantra is not thinking. It is simply stating truth and affirming that the continuity problem was never a problem, that we made a mistaken assumption, and that now is concurrent with time. Concurrent with time, meaning at the same instant as time arose, the non-judgment also was there, not needing any time or space to remain as it is. So what going forward here during this time now of Peter the Roman, where the tribulation period no doubt will kick into high gear, and the need to sidestep it will be there, and all of this, how is that going to take place? So I just assume that more attraction towards the maha-mantra, more attraction to it. And of course it's supremely difficult, there's no question about it, because it's curtains for the ego, and the ego resists it at all costs. The ego bargains at all costs. The ego's a bargainer. The ego's a great bargainer. It says, hey, I'll switch the maha mantra for a whole bunch of other mantras. Here's 50 mantras, but don't take the maha mantra. Or I'll worship you if you just don't press this issue, and all this stuff. The ego bargains. But you just have to, don't bargain, don't just state now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. And that stabilizes the mind. See, the mind becomes more stable. So we have gone through the last 2 weeks, in case you haven't noticed, have been a time of incredible instability, actually. Very difficult time, actually, because so much has shifted and changed. If you notice, in driving, people are so distracted. They are just, and at work, people are making mistakes. Their mind, they realize they're just so fragmented and distracted, and they realize that stuff is coming, and it's just, they're having a hard time keeping it together. And so it is on. It is full on right now. It is full on. And fortunately, I've been able to ride the wave thus far. And I'm still standing on the board. Haven't wiped out. And I'm going to continue to see what comes next and how it goes. And the ultimate aim of all teaching is to attract to the maha mantra so that people actually use it. You see, the ego tries to bargain and says, I'll tell you what, I can't use it, but I'll do it. Anything else you want me to do. That's why some gurus run into trouble. They're bargainers too. Because people will say, I'll do anything you want, anything. I just can't quite do the maha mantra, so let's make a deal. And the guru just has to say, well, you have to work up to it. You have to keep working up to it. There's no other remedy. It's like a medicine that has to be taken. It's a remedy that has to be taken, because the mind has to be stabilized. Mind has to accept that there is no problem. And of course, if it's dashing around, it feels, oh, there's, I got a problem. I got problems everywhere. There's problems everywhere. Mind has to realize that there's never been a problem. There's never been a continuity issue. And that there has to be a way for the mind. It's amazing how this maha mantra has worked for me. Amazing. I'll be in the midst of something that is just trying to absolutely grab my mind and my thoughts, and I'll just somehow say, now is concurrent with time, and boom, come out of it. Like a Houdini. It's really like a Houdini. You become like Houdini. It's amazing. Somehow this mantra enables one, the now of it, just, I might be fragmented. I say, uh-oh, I'm starting to get lost here. And suddenly, now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. And then, boom, within a matter of a second or two, suddenly I free myself from this whole massive complex, a tricky complex that's trying to get a hold. And I know that if I don't get free of it, I'm going to be dragged down for a long time. Suffer a lot. I haven't been suffering mentally since I've been using the maha mantra. There's not been any mental suffering, because I keep escaping from these attempts to engage my attention in futility, really, in futility. But again, from my own experience, I realize that to actually use the maha mantra, instead of just academically saying, okay, I see what it is, to actually apply it, as I've been doing constantly during the day, every day, constantly, no matter what I'm doing, I'm using it. I'm catching myself. Hundreds of times I catch myself. Wow, my attention was wandering. I caught it. It was wandering again. Caught it. Bring it back to that central statement of truth. That's real meditation. That's true meditation. Applying it in your everyday life. When things are, everything's happening. Stuff is happening. Stuff comes out of right field, left curveballs everywhere, you know. It's like, wow. And then you, instead of saying, oh, poor me, whoop, no. Now is concurrent with time. No matter what, or wow, I'm so good at this maha-mantra. Whoops, no. Now is concurrent with time. I'm really going to help the world with it. Nope, now is concurrent with time. The mind keeps, it wants to get away from this, you see. Fear is causing to flee. It doesn't want to look within because it thinks that it looks within upon devastation and a gap of darkness, continuity issue. And you say, no, now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent, mean same instant, non-judgment upon all hypotheticals. Was present at the same instant as the first hypothetical what if was entertained. Same instant. So there's never been a gap. So I'll just keep test piloting this. Now it's concurrent with time. And see what happens. Now my dreams have changed. Big change in my dreams. Very different. I actually woke up one morning and this like feminine goddess like voice said to me, "You didn't come visit me last night," and she's upset. You know, the goddess of dreams, some level of consciousness when you dream, going there into some kind of worldly traveling or searching or whatever. I got this complaint. I didn't come visit them last night because I didn't in my dreams, and I haven't been. My dreams have been smoother and shallower. And empty, much more empty, and empty of all the turmoil. It's kind of like there's like a stability in my dreaming too, and peacefulness and stability there too, as well as my day and certain things in my day, situations that I know are going to cause me severe problems, they're avoided. Amazing. So there is power in this maha mantra. I'm seeing it. In subtle ways. It's not, it doesn't really slap you in the face or anything like that. It's not like that. It's subtle. But really, as far as my equanimity, much better. As soon as you get upset, starting to get upset with something, there's a lot of things upset that has happened. I simply, instead of being upset, I go, oh, Now is concurrent with time. Now, and then my mind is on that, and the upset's gone. It starts to come back. Now is concurrent with time. And it's not there anymore. So this has been a revelation that actually getting down to business now. We're on the business side of things. In other words, what works. The showy side of things, we've been there, done that, which is fine. But now we get down to the business side of things, which is what actually works. And it's amazing changes in my life, subtle changes, things I would do before that were a little bit time wasting. I'm not doing anymore. I say, wait a minute. I don't want that trouble. I'm planting a garden, for instance, and I have all these flowers I was going to plant. I had all these marigolds. I'm going to plant them. And then I started thinking, wait a minute. Last year, that attracted the gophers. Actually, the gophers, they said they don't like marigolds. They love marigolds, actually. They just ate them all, almost. Just, oh, it was incredible. And it caused havoc in the garden, just havoc. And I said, you know what? I don't want the gophers showing up in my garden this year. So I'm not going to even plant the marigolds. I'm not going to even plant the flowers there. Forget it. That's an amazing thing for me, because for me it's flowers first and then the fruit. Now I'm saying no, fruit first, forget the flowers. Forget it. I don't need the gophers. Don't need the trouble. That's just a complete, like, 180 degree change. So, like, priorities sort themselves out now much, much better. Like, what's a priority? What's important? What do I need to focus on? All that stuff is having a subtle, powerful effect. And this is what the gurus and their students have always reported throughout history, is that you get into doing a maha mantra, it's going to have profound effects for you. Profound effects, which is, I'm seeing those subtly. It's a subtle thing. If you start to become wiser, and you say, wait a minute, why do we want gophers to show up and cause us all sorts of havoc? No, don't want that. I said, but surely I bought the flowers, I have to use them, right? I said, no, I don't have to use them. Or I can use them somewhere else that gophers are not a problem or something. And so a lot of subtle changes are taking place simply from applying this. So, I've always said that a great guru is super helpful in the world. Why? Because they attract people towards actually using a maha mantra. They actually attract people that way. That's true. So I always hold out hope that there's going to be some super guru in the world who will attract us to using the maha mantra, because it's time for that. We need to do that. And I know the resistance. There's a tremendous resistance to do it. And it helps to have somebody help us, actually. It helps to have... Imagine if you met someone whose mind was completely steady. Completely calm, completely steady, effortlessly steady. It's amazing. It's amazing. I've only seen pictures of those gurus. I never met one in person that's like that. I've met several gurus in the world, etc., and on videos and stuff, but I've never come across one right now that has that absolute steadiness and certitude. Not in person. But to meet one like that, that like says, hey, wait a minute, maybe I can start applying some affirmation. Maybe I can do it. So we shift from, it's too difficult, to, hey, maybe we can do it. That's the benefit. That is the benefit of a great, great teacher, is we start thinking that, hey, maybe we can do it. Maybe it's worth the effort. Maybe we should try. That kind of thing. So I don't know what it takes to get someone to actually try, but it takes a lot. It takes a lot. For me, it's a lifetime of effort. It's taken a lifetime of effort before I'm even willing to even try. It's amazing. I've been using different prayers and mantras my whole life. Affirmations and things like that started out when I was, when I was 20 or something. But none of them didn't work. None of them worked, really. I never experienced any success with it. But this maha mantra is different. I'm experiencing great success very quickly. There's a difference between someone saying Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, or there's a difference between Om, Om Namah, Om Namah, and there's a difference between that and a maha mantra. There's a difference. There's a difference. We can chant, you know, chant, and Jesus, 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 or over and over and over and over, ma, whatever people do, all sorts of different things they do, prayers, affirmations, etc. But it doesn't really have the traction I've noticed. It's more just a way to spend time to try to say, well, I'm preoccupied with this. But the maha mantra is different. It's different. It has the capacity to, like, pull you out of stuff like this, like this, like this, like this, like this, like instantly center you and somehow break the hold that these complexes have on you. Break their hold like that. It's a different thing. I'm really experiencing that. And of course, I was very skeptical, saying, look, nothing I've ever done has ever worked. So why should this work? And somehow I was able to start using it. Because I felt that it would work. Because it occurred to me internally. It just sort of arose within me, saying, this is your maha mantra. Say this maha mantra. So again, the mantra just occurred to my mind. No one told me this or that. It just came up in my own mind, saying, this will work for you. This will work. This is the, you know, now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. And so it makes sense to me. It seems like this is right on the mark. It hits the bullseye. It's a bullseye. So it's going to work. It's going to somehow it's going to bring about the results, the desired results that I want. Somehow I don't know how, but I have the feeling. I have this feeling that it's going to work. I think Sri Nisargadatta spoke about how when he met his guru, for some reason, he said, he can't explain it, he trusted his guru implicitly, and his guru said, just do this, or I don't know if it was a mantra or something, he said, just do what I tell you to do, just do it. And Sri Nisargadatta said that he trusted and believed that what his guru was telling was absolutely true, and therefore he just did it. And he really had phenomenal success. He really awoke to, he was free of delusion. And he credits this because he simply did what his guru suggested he do, which is very rare. It is a very rare situation like that. That's an amazing situation. But it must be that it occurred to him that this will work. He said, yeah, I see it. This is going to work. My guru is telling me accurately this is going to work. So I had the same experience. I feel that this maha mantra is going to work. It's going to work. So, of course, I'm applying it. I keep thinking I'm going to get tired of it, but now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. And so ultimately, we want those in the world who are able to inspire others to get into affirmations, affirming truth, more and more blanket statements, until finally a maha mantra will emerge for them, or one will seem right for them. Whether it's this one or another one, there are different forms of the maha mantra that are effective, super effective. That is the ultimate goal at this time. That it's always been the ultimate goal, but never more so than now, because we're really headed into the tribulation period. And it's all important to be able to pull your mind out of the darkness as it keeps trying to step into the mud and the tar pits. And we have to stay on this, like we're walking a straight and narrow path through these tar pits, and we keep wanting to stick our foot in the tar, and we have to say, whoops, don't do that. Now is concurrent with time. And that lifts your foot out of the tar, and you keep walking straight along the narrow path. And if one doesn't have a way to do that, then the ship is going to sink. So it is important, and at the same hand, it's difficult. If you haven't prepared, it is extremely difficult, really. I mean, I don't expect people to be able to do it if they haven't prepared. How can they do it? They'll start asking questions. Now, wait a minute, you know, why is this working? How can this work? For me, I don't ask those questions. As soon as I start asking a question, right back, now it's concurrent with time. Because that's just simply I know it's a statement of truth. I know it's a statement that the continuity problem is not a problem, which is the only issue that we have, the assumption that it is a problem. So this addresses the only issue we really have. The only one we really have. It directly addresses it. So there's no reason for anything else. There's no reason to question, is it going to work or not? Of course it will. Of course, there's no doubt about it. Reminding ourselves of what is true has to work. There's no way that it cannot work. So I don't ask myself questions about it. I just do it. But that's what it takes. That's what the success, it requires you just simply to finally just do it. Just do it. Step over the line. You draw a line for the, was it the chicken? You draw a line in front of the chicken. The chicken is looking at the line and can't step over the line. At some point, you know, the chicken has to be distracted and it goes over the line and says, ah, that wasn't so bad. And the ego says, it's going crazy because all you can say is now is concurrent with time. You don't engage me anymore. How come you don't visit me anymore? You don't send me flowers anymore. Why? What's the matter with you? The ego feels like it's losing your interest. You're losing interest in the ego. And the ego is kind of like a suitor who's worried. Say, oh, they're losing interest in me. What can I do? What can I do? Here, let me toss them a bouquet or something. And you just say, no, now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. And the ego says, wow, they don't seem to be interested anymore. How come you don't come visit me anymore? You don't like me anymore? I don't respond to that. Just say, now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. Because the ego is just an idol. Just an idol, which means nothing. It's just a way that we hide the fact that we're the ones who are entirely in control of this dream and giving ourselves this dream and pursuing the objectives. But we keep thinking it's coming from someplace other than us. That's what an idol is. It just means someplace other than us. But there isn't any place other than us for this dream. The origin of the dream is us entirely. We're entirely responsible for it. And it's entirely necessary for us to set it down. And we set it down by having a dream that mimics reality, which is the dream of non-judgment. Because reality is not judging itself at all. There's no judgment in reality at all. There's no search. There's no search in reality at all. So we have to have that, a dream which is, there's no search at all. There's no judgment at all. And that's the blessing, the overlay of all dreaming. And we have to choose that. It's up to us. No idol can choose it for us because idol is nothing. It's simply our own advice to ourselves being looped through nothing, like a mirror, and us thinking that it's coming from the mirror. Like, imagine if we look in a mirror and we think the mirror is producing everything in the mirror. And we're like spellbound, like Narcissus, looking at this mirror and believing the mirror is producing this incredible movie. Oh my gosh, no. Mirror isn't doing anything, really. It's reflecting, but it's not really doing anything. It's an idol. So the ego is just an idol, and so we're losing interest in idols. As we do this maha mantra, we lose interest in idols because they have nothing to tell us, right? Because we know now is concurrent with time. That's all we need to know. Don't need to know anything else, as a matter of fact. No, nothing else we need to know. That statement is all we need to know. So why do we need to spend time, with the ego, with idols? We don't need it. We don't need it. So the idols begin to deflate. They begin to deflate. And that's the real spiritual path. That's the real spiritual effectiveness of it all. So I don't know how it's going to go in the future, except to try to attract others to the using towards the maha mantra, which is all important. Now, how to do that, we'll see. We will see. Maybe there'll be a way. I expect that there should be. There probably would be. Perfectly reasonable that there will be. I don't know what state of mind others are in, except to say that struggling, probably, but say that I don't see anyone that's not struggling in this world. Really don't see anyone that's not struggling. With maybe, you know, the obvious acceptance of those who are awakened, whoever those may be, but other than that, everyone is really struggling and trying to make a deal. And so what we need to do is just remain calm, remain patient, use whatever affirmations you can use at this point. If you get in trouble, I say, if I can't quite pull this affirmation up, I say, God is God, truth is true, then now is concurrent with time. So start with like just one easy statement, truth is true, or God is God, truth is true, truth is true. And then now is concurrent with time. Truth is true. God is God. Now is concurrent with time. God is God. Truth is true. Now is concurrent with time. And this just aligns your mind with truth, which is what we need to do now. Align our minds with truth. This hasn't been... I hope it's been recording. I don't know. I really don't know. Hold on a second. One second here. Hold on a second. 1 second here. It's probably been recording. So as far as stability of mind goes, we don't need anything else. That's what I'm realizing. What happens, the ego tries to tell us like, well, how do you get stability without the maha mantra? Can you show me? And you say, no. God is God. Truth is true. Now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. And the ego says, well, that's great. Wow, you got it. And that's great. And can you show me some other way? And you say, God is God, truth is true, now is concurrent with time. God is God, truth is true, now is concurrent with time. And the ego again will say, wow, yeah, you're really good at practicing that. This is amazing. You're really great. And then just say, nah, God is God, truth is true, now is concurrent with time. The ego will say, do you know how great you are? I mean, how great are you going to be? Isn't that amazing? You're going to be someone really amazing. And you just say, God is God, truth is true, now is concurrent with time. You have a blast with this, actually. It's very, very fun, very insightful, amazing how you see how sneaky the ego is and how you're able to just say, no, now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. Don't attack the ego. Say, ego, shut up. No, don't say that. Just go, now is concurrent with time. Don't even address the ego. Don't say, shut up. Don't say, be quiet. Don't say, hey, that's a stupid question, or why are you doing this? Or don't argue with it. Don't berate it. Don't do anything. Don't respond to idols at all. Don't even respond to them, because they're nothing. They're all built up based on our fear of the continuity problem, that there's a problem with continuity. That's 100%. So just state there is no continuity problem. I mean, now is concurrent with time, meaning there is no continuity problem. We don't need idols at all. We don't even need them. So why waste time trying to revive them by speaking with them? That just revives them. Because if you speak to an idol, you yourself have to make the idol respond. So that revives the idol, as it were. Because... Who is speaking? Who is responding? We are. We're the ones doing it. Just pretending that there's an intermediary, an idol there, but there's not. It's really not at all. So God is God. Truth is true. Now is concurrent with time. Now, the non-judgment is concurrent, the same instant as time, as the what-if scenario. Time is a what-if scenario. What if reality weren't real? What if God's will wasn't fixed? What if we could change reality? What if we could become prime creator? What if, what if, what if? Those are all what ifs. And God simply gives a perfect non-judgment upon all what ifs, not addressing any in specifically or at all. See, God is totally non-specific as far as addressing any what ifs. Blanket non-judgment upon all what ifs, regardless of any content or what the what if, regardless of the form of the what if. God pays no attention to the form whatsoever, none. And so we need to train our mind in this way. Now is concurrent with time. God is God, truth is true, now is concurrent with time. Train our minds that way, and then it will be easy to accept the blessing, the vision of oneness, vision of non-judgment. Which needs no time to be what it is. That's why it's called blissful. Bliss is bliss because it's not needing any time to be what it is. That's why it's blissful. If it needed time to be what it is, it wouldn't be blissful. There'd be a search going on. There'd be an effort going on. Bliss is effortless. It's right now. It doesn't need require anything to be what it is. It doesn't require any judgments to be made. We're in a good place. We're in a good place. Very good place. Very good place. And if something bad tries to grab a hold of you, fearful, something fearful, will just go right back. Don't address the fear. Just say, oh, God is God, truth is true, now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. You don't have to understand it intellectually so much. It's just to center yourself on this fact. It's like building your foundation of your house on a rock. That's the real rock. The rock of Peter, the rock, the foundation is the maha-mantra. God is God, truth is true, now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time is a steady foundation. And all these storms come and try to blow your house down. You just keep stating, no, my foundation is completely solid, totally stable. Don't argue with the idols whether it's stable or not. Then that argument itself will be unstable. Argumentation is inherently unstable. So just say, God is God, truth is true, now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. Just reaffirm truth. The way to deal with all these tricky issues is simply to reaffirm truth. Don't argue with idols. And that's a good little saying to end this video with. Don't argue with idols. Just reaffirm truth. Okay. All right. Very great. Keep going forward. Keep going forward now. Take the stability of mind seriously. Have to. You have to take it seriously now. There's no time for losing right now. There's no time for making a mess of things right now. Have to get it right. Have to get it right. Have to finish strong here. All right. Very great. That's it.